Greetings to you all. In March 2023, Science Museum in London hosted a science fiction film festival. The festival program included such sci-fi classics as 2001: A Space Odyssey, Blade Runner: The Final Cut, as well as more recent movies including Sunshine, Wall-E, and of course Christopher Nolan's epic movies Interstellar and Tenet. The last screening of the festival was Interstellar, and I'm grateful to Science Museum for letting me into the projection booth to film the lacing process. This is even more exciting because actual film screenings are becoming more and more rare, and not a lot of people have a chance to see them. Just before I start, I'd like to encourage you to subscribe to Bortech channel. There is only a few more hundred needed to reach 3000 subscribers. You can even consider supporting future videos on Patreon. You will find all links in the description down below. And one more thing, watch this video till the very end to get a chance to win one of these three 70mm IMAX film cells of Christopher Nolan's 2017 movie Dunkirk. Here I am, back at the Science Museum's Ronson Theatre. In October 2022 I was here to film a tour video. You will find the link in the description down below in case you haven't seen it. For tonight's screening, projection manager Matt Raymond and projectionist Tom Smith will be preparing this IMAX GT projector. First of all, a special puck have to be placed in the center of the base platter, which will stop it from spinning and which will also help to guide the platter with the actual film on it. To move this 300 kg film reel, they are using this hand-lifting winch with extended forks. I personally would have been under enormous stress if I had to move this film reel. From what I heard, a print of a movie on 70mm film cost around $40,000, and that's not including copyright fees. Watching these guys work, you can say they are true professionals. After the platter is in correct position, the center puck can be removed.
Oh, I can hear them.
Yeah, well, back this way. Yeah, a bit more there. There you go.
When these two pins pop through the holes, it is an indication that the platter is locked and ready to go. They are putting Velcro strap on the outer edge to hold the film nice and secure. You don't want this film to get loose under any circumstances, so there is another security feature.
These clamps we're putting on now are the specially designed clamps for Interstellar. So because of the length of it, the Christopher Nolan are maxing out the platters. IMAX redesigned these clamps to fit underneath and allowing as much film as possible to go on the platter. So previously they used to screw in these holes here. So that used to be the max you used to be able to have up to here.
Next step would be to remove the ring from the center of the film coil. Now Matthew starts coiling up the leader to go through the projector.
So we have a lot of like rough gash film so we can handle it without having to worry about damaging it.
It was a truly genius solution to feed the film from the center of the coil. It excludes the need of rewinding it, reduces the turnaround time and prolongs the lifespan of the print. Here's the feed unit. It controls the speed of the platter itself. As the film is fed through, there is a sensor which monitors the film moving through the feed unit and that dictates the speed of the platter.
We have a nice little marking on there to make it nice and clear for anybody who picks this up.
There we go,
and now we'll just start to lace it through the projector, so we'll take it through. And now we just go over the matte PTR rollers we have, just to get any dust and dirt off there.
These two chunky cylinders are called particle transfer rollers, or just PTR. They are designed to clean the motion picture film from dust or other particles while it passes through them. This is where the lacing through the projector starts. This projector is capable of playing IMAX 3D movies, but Interstellar is just a regular movie. They will be using the lower deck, which would be displaying images for the left eye if that would be a 3D movie. This is a very important moment. The frame mark has to be locked in this exact position. Otherwise, the image and the sound would run out of sync. After the film is locked, Matthew has to make sure that film is in the correct position and it's sitting there nice and flat. Now he is creating a loop, which is crucial for projection to operate correctly. When the loop is created, the film can be locked on the other side of the projector too. If that would have been a 3D movie, the exact process would have been repeated on the top deck too. Now the wiper bars have to be inserted. These fabric bars are an additional measure which allows the image on the screen to be kept clean by wiping the lens. The projectionist has to ensure that these wiper bars are firmly in place, because if they come out, it can jam the projector and damage the film. Next comes the lens, which also have to be spotless, as even tiny dust particles would be magnified and become visible. Now that everything is lined up, the main lens can be moved in a position. As the film is fed through the projector, a vacuum holds it to the front of the glass.
And just before we move, give it a little turn. We can hear all the noises that it makes, nice. And then we just finish up lacing. We clean it on the output side as well, just get rid of any more of that dust and dirt. And we drop it down to here. And if we just around this side, we'll go back to the arm. So we bring it back to these rollers. And then there's the arm under here, which is going to make sure it's under tension when we come back to the platter. And we go forwards and backwards onto that twice. And then we wrap it around the center ring. Yeah, of course, now if I can. Now it's a big flick. And hopefully I won't ever miss it. And then we just make sure it's under tension. That's nicely. And as it starts to take up now, the film will go under tension. We'll just make sure it doesn't pop off any of the rollers, because occasionally the new projector position we have, sometimes it does pop off. And now the film itself is locked in and ready just to us to test by hand and then take it from there, really.
Amazing. The lacing of the projector is now complete. Tom is going to jog the film for a bit to make sure that it runs okay and it doesn't pop off of any rollers.
So again, we mark up the film with quite a lot of marks, just to give us an indication.
After Tom and Matthew have done their checks, the projector hood can now be closed.
So that locks in now, say we're happy. So that is the film fully laced now. So we need to just make sure that the platter system's locked in and engaged. So at the moment it's got left eye, and that's what we're running on the projector. We need to tell that one to lock in. So now that's fully locked. We've told the projector to be left eye on the lamp. So now we just do our checks to make sure it's not hanging off any rollers and everything, no mistakes have been made. So me and Tom will go and we'll check each other's work. We'll just go from one from the input side, one from the output side. And we physically make sure we touch the rollers just to make sure we are checking the film properly.
What I now understood after watching these guys is that there is never enough checks. That's not a surprise, as a mistake can cost tens of thousands of pounds worth of damage and you could run the risk of losing the whole film print. I believe it is time to have a look at the heart of the projector, the massive xenon lamp.
So this is one IMAX lamp, so 15,000 watts. They last approximately, 1,000 hours before we need to change them out. They're water cooled and air cooled, so the anode and the cathode have water continuously pumping through them. And they're filled with xenon gas, which is 24 times the atmospheric pressure. So if they were to be knocked when being put in, they will shatter and explode and damage the projector and also yourself. So we wear big Kevlar sort of vests and face masks when we're handling these. So these are quite heavy as well, and there's two of these in the projector.
Are these two lamps combined into one beam?
So it's one for each eye. So if you're doing a 3D film, so at the moment we're going to use one for the 2D, and when using 3D, yeah, we have the two on.
Great. And the last thing left to do is to make sure that the sound system is functioning correctly and it's ready for the screening.
Yeah, we're just going to do a quick audio check because we have the film system in conjunction with the lasers. They run from the same sound system, but the way they switch over is slightly different. We can only have one or the other. So just before we start, we like to give it a little test. So we have a very big sort of space shuttle launch switch to flick over to the IMAX system. There it comes, Tom. 3, 2, 1.
Yeah, that's right.
So we're happy with the sound now.
You might be wondering, where does the sound for 70mm IMAX movies comes from, as there is no room for a soundtrack on the actual film. The reality is that the whole soundtrack is delivered on a separate optical disc.
Yeah, so and we always load it. So whilst you can play it from the DVD drive, we always load it to the hard drive and eject the disc. So it's not playing in time. So we do load it to the hard drive and it plays directly from there, yeah.
Keeping image and sound in sync is crucial, so IMAX developed a reliable solution to ensure that.
And then we have two syncs. One sends the projector time back to here, to the sound system. Another one, if I show you here, sends a frame count here to the console. So that'll be a frame count to here and then a frame count to the sound system. And once we lock those two together, the projector time and the show time go in simultaneously and perfectly in sync.
The difference between conventional cinema sound formats and IMAX is that IMAX doesn't have a dedicated low frequency effect channel, the so-called LFE. All six channels are full range and the sub-bass is filtered out and redirected to subwoofers with the help of the processor slash crossover.
Yeah, so for the film system it will go into this Yamaha processor. We used to have individual digital EQs for each channel, but since the upgrade, yeah, it goes through this Yamaha processor and then out through the current new upgraded sound system through the amps and then out to speakers.
All right, I guess it is time to find my seat in the auditorium and enjoy the movie. Meanwhile, have a look at this stunning time-lapse of the 70mm film running through IMAX GT projector. This optomechanical spectacle lasted for nearly 3 hours, during which 17 kilometers of film passed through the projector. Speaking about film, if you want to have a chance to win one of these beautiful 70mm IMAX film cells, which were given to me by the Science Museum, you have to like this video, subscribe to Vortech channel and leave a comment. I want IMAX film cell, followed by the country and your city or town. I will post them to any country in the world which can be reached by UK Royal Mail. I will randomly select 3 winners after this video reaches 10,000 views and announce them here. Good luck! I have finally seen the 70mm IMAX projector in action and I had so much fun filming it. Before I wrap this up, I'd like to thank the Science Museum for making this video possible, especially projection manager Matt Raymond. projectionist Tom Smith, press assistant Laura Nebut, and head of commercial experiences Mark Cutmore. Thank you very much for watching. Don't forget to subscribe, and I'll see you soon. Goodbye.